Those who are sitting at the back, please come and occupy the front seats. Please. Those who are sitting at the back, please come forward. Please come forward.
Beginnings 20,000 years ago, on behalf of all the great saints and sages, philosophers, Born in this country. It's got another 50 or 60 years to go. to take us forward intellectually, philosophically, spiritually, religiously.
Srimati Ramanujai Ma. We are well aware that today we have taken the topic of India Century Mission. So the name itself gives a clear idea that it is going to bring a wide, deep impact as well as a transformation which is not only within the country but from the country to the various parts of the globe. By saying there are a lot of words which are for comfort, which are for consolation, which are just for boosting the person's capability and performance, lot of things are done just explained in the Shastras and exposed by people in their speeches, like you are having all infinite potential inside, do everything, achieve success. These things are very potential words, but unless they reflect in capable personalities or receptacles, these words are just boosters and they don't become the sense of fructification unless it is executed by a capable person. So likewise, if you start that it is India Century Mission, as it has been told already by great saints and seers before several decades or even centuries or even millenniums in various records, and what it has created as its influence in the society and how many people they have come forward and what is the gravity of their impact and contribution to society in bringing India Century. So this is the thing, already it has been told by somebody before several decades and we are repeating the same. And what is the gap between these two recitations or their attainment or injunction, and what we are really going to achieve? This India Century Mission is not a myth, it is not a mystery, it is not a miracle. Something without anybody's contribution, it is not going to bud in a dusk and blossom in a dawn. And it is not also a myth, as it is considered by somebody taking into account the geopolitical exposures and variations that we observe now. It is not also a mystery, for it is obvious that we have records of our historical pride and greatness which can be incessantly maintained in the society with a renaissance. So it is neither a myth, nor a mystery, nor a miracle. It requires a mega project as well as with a master plan. So it is a mega project because it includes the transformation of millions of people. It requires the influence of thousands and thousands of volunteers, think tanks, executors, etc. So it is an organizational building which is a mega plan, which is a mega project, and it requires also some time, dedication, energy, risk and financial resources and whatever that is required for any political institution or academic institution or social institutions. Likewise, it must be well organized and practically implemented. So here we have to go through the previous history. We are having the empty asafoetida. We used to have a lot of these asafoetida bags and asafoetida blankets and pockets in which we used to have the residue of the smell, the fragrance that existed in the content earlier. Likewise, the historical pride of us, no doubt that is real, that is not based on mere exaggerations or misinterpretations or self-appraisal. They do have reality, but what is the practical possibility of bringing the same thing in that? When compared to that of the other civilizations which are there in mathematics, trade, navigation, socialization, construction technology, moral ethics, architecture, etc. Few civilizations to name, that the Arabics and as well as the Greek civilization, as well as the Chinese, they are said to be the inventors of various things, and even the greatest inventions or their contributions are nothing but as per the proclamation of talented seers and historians of reality and genuinity, they have attributed even those contributions as a contribution of their Indic annexure or connectivity through invasion, trade and migrations. So such is the greatness of our India, that is a historical pride. That historical pride that must be brought into real practical views, and there are some problems which we want to just notify here, and how to eradicate those things and to create a vitalized society will be the theme of the speech. And the third thing is, there is dharma, you know. Dharmo dharayati prajaha, dharana dharma ityahu. It has been told that dharma is the eternal spirit It is the vital element that governs everything. Everything is created, sustained and dissolved by and in Dharma. So Dharma is common and universal. We cannot say that India only has Dharma and all the other people, they have no Dharma at all. But the difference, the speciality of the salient features of the Dharma of this Bharatavarsha and Bharatadesha is different from Dharma of the other civilizations. The instinctive ethics, the instinctive morale is governed in all human beings or in all creatures in their respective ambience and gravity. But there are two things we want to say. We know the types of respiration. For example, if you take the fish out of water, it will die. If you put some mammal or reptile which cannot get that this hydrospheric oxygen, which cannot get that oxygen, if you put them into water, they will die. If you take out of water, it will die. If you put, that will die. Because each and everybody, they respire the oxygen from the hydrospheric and atmospheric backgrounds. Likewise, no doubt everybody, they have Dharma for their existence, but that type of Dharma in subtlety, in primordial nature is more because it is the birthplace of Dharma. This is the place where Dharma, number one, Chaitanya, consciousness, number three, divinity, number four, Acharya, that is the lineage. All these things are conglomerated, contemplated only in this area. That is the salient feature for our land. We have Acharya Parampara, that is the spiritual lineage. The scriptural lineage, that is the Shastra Parampara. Then understanding of divinity and manifestations is rightly taught about the consciousness which is present in all elements, insentient and sentient. So these salient features, they distinguish. For example, if anybody does Dharma or not, that is entirely different. That is a supportive faculty. But far as the basic Dharma is our life itself. Vidusho atikrame danda bhuyastvam. Persons who are there in Dharma, those who are entered into the values of ethical nature and morale, by the gradual upgradation of the civilization, that is utterly different from people, those who are rooted, roasted, toasted in dharmic principles. And if we are apparent from the orbit of Dharma, if we are derooted from the axis of perfection and precision of our traditional values, the impact will be heavy than any person doing the same. Because we are having a dharmic base and our operation will have a deeper impact. The impact will be very colossal. And the practical implementation of Dharma, the benefit will also be more to us. And also if a person is aberrant, the ill effect will be more. It makes us to have the carrier of, to be the conveyor of global consciousness, global harmony, global civilization and global leadership as a consequence. That is the greatness of us. Likewise, I want to say three differences from making the historical pride to be implemented in these present situations. First thing is the persons available, second thing is the position, the ecosphere or the atmosphere, whatever you say, social, economical, political, other things. And three thing is the people, the mentality, mental setup and receptivity. So the first thing is, when the historical periods, that is the periods of Vaivasvata, Manuatri, Sambhata, Katyayana, Brihaspati, Parasara, Vyasa, Shankha, Ligita, Daksha, Gautama, Shatatapa, Pulastya, Karma, these people, they existed. And the aspiration and inspiration given by these personalities which radiated the Varahamihira, Chanakya and various other people, they are known as Shastragnyas. So those people, the scholarly people, the scientific community, the sages and seers, we have lot of people with various levels of spiritual gravity. So the persons who existed for promulgation of this pride to be translated into potential action and impact, such a type of people accept their treatises, accept their messages available in transliteration and translation, such type of people, they don't exist now. Number two, the atmosphere in which they nourished, the atmosphere in which they have been irrigated, the people have been irrigated and fostered with the knowledge, the same type of conduciveness that does not exist now. And persons, the receptacles, that is the shrotas or the svikartas, those people, they were totally getting into the field of surrender. The field of surrender, the field of service and field of sacrifice. These three things are essential for getting into scriptural and spiritual receptivity. So service for others and sacrifice at the case of any distress and despair, as well as total surrender to the eternity, divinity and truth. So these type of things don't exist. So this India Century Mission, I have already told, it may appear to be a myth or miracle or a chauvinistic approach for each and every Indian, each and every person. Like we have French pride, we have the German pride, we know about the British colonial pride. It means they always, they wanted to rule the world. What was the pride of Alexander? So it is not a pride, without any rational background or with the sense of just colonization or permeation or imperialism. It is not India's century in that manner. It is to take a maternal care of the globe. It is to take the paternal care and concern for the knowledge development of the course. It is to take the preceptorial guidance for the world. So yesterday I told in a lecture that we say that we are great not because of our arrogance or self-appraisal. We claim that we are great because we want everybody to be great, and our greatness lies in making others great. So it is not just arrogance or self-appraisal. So likewise, we have to create India Century Mission. It is a mega project and master plan, and no doubt we know that now we are having more members. The Christian community now, which is ruling nearly one third of the global population, it was started, implanted only in 12 hearts. There are only 12 disciples of Jesus, and the way in which they follow, it has been implanted in such a manner that it had uninterrupted lineage, follow up, commitment in spreading the message with an institutionalization, a project of institutionalization. It is conceptualized, visualized and institutionalized. So that has made one third of the population. We have more numbers than what we had. But we may have to create the impact. Mere quantitative comparison, it will not come for the rescue. So that is the greatness of our country, that all the others, for them, the dharma may be food or water. For us, the vital breath itself is dharma. We have sukshma dharma, we have parama dharma, we have adhyatmika dharma. So our dharma is entirely different. It does not only comprise the thing with the physical, cultural, psychic and intellectual moorings, but also understanding of the self, understanding of the ultimate reality and understanding of the process of emancipation. So it deals with eschatology, metaphysics, cosmology, ontology, on various other sciences which are impalpable to modern science and technology. So that is the greatness of us. So we have started a process of India Century Mission. So as the time is very limited, I have to just quote what are the properties of India Century Mission as well as the projects. Number one, I have already told that it is to be institutionalized. We have to take care of stabilization of our own nature. There are two types of India Century Mission message. One is the message of India. Message of India. It is given to the people or subjects of India. It is for stabilization. Second is the message from India for the global community, that is for dissemination. So unless we stabilize ourselves, we cannot just go for dissemination of knowledge to other people. We do have the evil heads of poverty, malnutrition, infant mortality, female infanticide is also there. Then employment, education, lot of problems are there. So unless we stabilize ourselves, unless we make it as a movement, which must have a broader, wider and deeper network, we cannot get into dissemination at all. Number one, it starts with education. Forgetting about the other community, the budding community at a time of impressionable age, they must be instilled in the value-based education. Value is of three types. One is the career value, second is the character value, and third is the course value. They have to understand what they study, that is the course. They have to understand what they are going to do in the course, that is career. How they are going to behave with the core denizens of this global community, that is known as the character. To behave within yourself, with your domestic, social, national and global spheres, how you are going to act and activate, that is there. So we have to start a value-based education, that is ethically based education, that is a religious-based education. Everybody thinks religious as a bias product. If you teach religion, it will create some sort of disparity and cleavage in the mind. It is not though. If it is untied, I've already told, if religion is not taught at all, if the knowledge of our heritage is not taught, you are in a dark room. If it is mispreached with chauvinism, extremism and fundamentalism, then you are in the same dark room with a black tiger. So these things are very dangerous. So it does not mean that secularism or something does not mean that you must not teach religion. Teaching religion in the real sense in which it preaches sympathy and empathy, altruism and cosmopolitanism, that is the greatness of real teaching. So number one, education. Number two, microfinancing and employment resources. We have to deal with employment resources. How to make employment resources. Number three, pooling up the resources of our nation. Most of the people contributing to foreign countries, no doubt they are earning much, but the contribution, for example, somebody told that lot of our Indians are there at NASA and various other international institutions. So it is good for inspiration. It is not for productivity. We have to retain the resources and youth potential by providing more opportunities. It is possible only by a public-private participation, a participation of a potential masculine government with a group of vibrant citizens and subjects of the nation. So employment is second. It is also very essential. Third is rural empowerment. So we have to make courses. We have India Century Mission. It has to make courses and action plans to do in all these areas. The third is rural development. And fourth thing is, we know how to behave when we are happy and safe. How to behave if you are in disasters, in communal disharmony and clashes. That type of disaster management and risk management and crisis control must be taught to the public at all. We have to create the resources management courses for the people, how to maintain the global and natural resources and prevent exploitation of the natural resources. I want to say two things very simply here. We are having a curse. The curse is responsible for the degradation. And we want development and we want a fuel for the development. We are having a lot of curse. Whenever the infraspecial entities like animals, birds and nature is mistreated, like the famous Victor Hugo, before a few centuries we have been teaching human beings how to behave with fellow humans. Now he is in such a pathetic condition, he must be taught how to behave with nature, animals, birds and insects. Such is the situation of these people. So these natural global resources maintenance must be there. If the persons he mistreats or ill-treats, his inferior species, he is mistreated and he is punished by nature. Nature is nothing but the will of God. It is the shadow of God. He is punished by God in the form of the natural resources refusal or in the form of natural disasters and man-made calamities. These things are the curses. Let's do the curses and what are the methodologies for eradication of the same. Second, what are the fuels that we want to get from the youth community, think tanks, academicians, responsible politicians and other members of the society, make it as a fuel, efficacious fuel to run this dynamism to get into fructification. So, harmony, religious harmony, domestic and social harmony must be taught. How to behave with your parents, how to maintain husband and wife relationship. As these things are just trivially, they must not be concerned, because an unhealthy, unhappy family, that only contributes an unhealthy nation. If a person is disturbed, for example, if a person is disturbed, he is betrayed by the society for employment resources. If he is a normal person, he will get into depression. But if the same person is fueled by circumstances, he will get into agitation, becoming a terrorist. He will spoil a lot of people, he will burn all the public properties and he will destroy everything. So we must not take this into trivial consideration, and teaching this way of harmony, self-reliance for our nation in energy resources, that is also very much essential. So considering this energy resources, harmony training and teaching, education, employment sources, rural employment sources, improving scientific temper and indigenous innovations in the nation, that is also very much important. Infrastructure management by roads, by essential construction of buildings and everything. So all of these things must be enlisted. It cannot be completed both in an oration or in implementation within the shortest duration. It requires a practical time. And certainly I believe that we have reached the dawn, and certainly it is going to not only radiate the persons available inside, it is having, the truth is having two powers. One is radiation and permeation. It radiates the persons who are available here, but it permeates the atmosphere in silence. It gets into the photomolecule particle and it vibrates. It details its remote nature, the nucleus of the essentialities of the truth, and it gets into all people who are like-minded and like-spirited. And I believe that with the wishes and blessings of already used today, whenever you take a task of God, whenever you take a task that is pre-sanctioned by God, whenever you take a task that is more or less proximate to divinity, eternity, purity and global righteousness, it is pre-sanctioned, pre-endorsed, pre-approved and pre-vitalized by God himself. So we are not taking a project which is for our own welfare. It is not for the collective welfare of a secular or a different type of community. It is for the global welfare. So we believe that we have the pre-sanctioned endorsement of God, and God resides in us as spirit, the spirit of speech, the spirit of action and the spirit of fructification of all of our collective and committed actions. I believe that this is going to be a great success, and we need not worry about the crowd at all, because of two reasons. One, we have to organize it in such a manner that we have to give advertisements, register the seats. We don't say that the spiritualism and all of these things, they don't affect much crowd. It is not like that. We see the Yogi Ram, the Ramdev Baba is there. He is from North India and he teaches yoga, and lots of people are there. Even there are crowd pullers like cine artisans and musicians and famous other political and social celebrities. We used to have also spiritual celebrities who are allure of mass crowds. It is because of their organization skill, media representation, more than what you have, how you present it in the society and through what channel and media, that is the great thing that gives you the effect. So the same thing, well organized, being presented in such an attractive, simple as well as a provoking manner. For example, if you say that how to manage your family and how to that is engross yourself in your work with success, and how to increase your wealth management, how to be a successful entrepreneur, all of these things which are directly connected with the people for immediate approach. Immediate, mediate and remote approaches are there. So religion or the society, nation and globe, they are in the remote approach of the people, and the mediate things are so much concerned with the knowledge improvement, knowledge management and status management. Immediate recruitment or clearment from, that is clearing from loans and clearing from their personal other predicaments and other things. Then mental peace and satisfaction, physical salubrity, all of these things are immediate requirements of the public. And whenever a person contacts something about immediate requirement, they are more attracted. We want people who are realized and committed. Even though we want some people to be attracted as a preliminary, attracting according to me, it is an inceptive and preliminary way. And mere attraction that will not bring commitment, if it is not with commitment, it is not going to give the fruit at all. So by properly making the India Century Mission as a network, for example, we can have net enrollment, net magazines and journals, e-journals we can start conducting a proper way of course of India Century Mission in schools, in corporate offices, and also for the householders and housewives in the form of either practical workshop as well as a symposium, and also in the form of distance education, then evening school, various other methodologies, even EduSat, InfoSchool, all of these modern education methods are there. Certainly we are going to plan them at the time of implementation of this India Century Mission as an institutionalized, pakka, precise, consummate project. We feel that we will be having thronging crowds who are really thirst of spiritual wisdom and who are really brave enough to contribute something for the society by their collective integrity, with sacrifice, service and sincerity. I have already revealed it. So I wish and bless, and I also pray to the lotus feet of the great ultimate reality Narayana to shower his choicest benedictions on the persons available here and persons who are available for the same mission not available in the auditorium, to have a collective integrity and come forward to organize it under the able leadership of N.S. Ramaswamy. Narayana, Narayana, Narayana.
Yes, the various kinds of networks, institutional arrangements, holistic approach towards propagation, dissemination, and you, all of us who are gathered here, those who think it's worth proceeding, let's do that. With these words, either we break for tea, coffee, if it is ready, and then Justice Rama Charles shall speak, or Justice Rama Charles can speak and then we break. There is Krishna, is the coffee ready? Then we break and come back. Or, coffee is ready? No. Continue with Rama Joy. Sir, may I request Justice Rama Joy? How do I describe him? I was in a depressed mood. The moment I said I would speak about Rama Joy, my energy has come back. It has come many times to our academy, Rotan Dharma, in several books of Sanatana Dharma, various interpretations in various languages. Yes, a source of strength and blessing to me personally and to everybody in this part of the world and India too. May I request him to speak on it.
Brothers and sisters, you have already heard a speech full of wisdom by Sri Rajshekaran, and has also heard a powerful keynote address by Chaturvedi Swamiji. Ramaswamy has been saying more than once about the number of invitations he has sent and the number of persons present here. I want to remind Ramaswamy of the words of Will Durant in History of a Civilization, wherein he said, the reformations or changes in the human society will come up.
You know that East is a resting place. It is known as Uday Disha. So it is a rising place and rest is there. I mean, it has been clearly told the people about being Karma Bhumi and Bhoga Bhumi. There are two things. If a person is interested in spiritual enhancement or material prosperity, they must have three requisites. One is Janma, that is being born. And second is Nivasa, migration. Pravasa or Nivasa, that is migration. And third thing is Ashraya, association. If a person wants a spiritual enhancement, either he must be born in the East, or he must be migrated to the East, or he must be associated with the persons or principles of East, and for material prosperity, vice versa. So this is how the people, they have classified it. Some other person is interested in speaking with their mobiles. So this is what we have qualified and classified between East and West. I want to say two defects of West. The one is they are having tools without the purpose. Second, they are very much vehement about attaining the purpose without having proper tools. I want to explain these two things with brevity. The first thing is we have been seeing a lot of colonization, globalization, then global marketing, enhancement of social standards of living, then also science and technology and boosting various other things they are doing. And what is the purpose? These things are the tools are the purpose of life. Science and technology, industrialization or urbanization are the tools for life for some other purpose or the purpose itself. It is not the purpose. Even a very unlettered person or a limitedly knowledgeable person, he won't just defend that it is a purpose. It is a tool for achieving some purpose. So any tool that has no purpose or that is having a purpose but not attaining it, not attaining the purpose but getting into some other adverse effect, all these things are destructive tools in disguise. So basically the purpose is harmony, peace, happiness, expansion of human contact and connectivity. All of these things are the purpose of the so-called tools. You must lead a qualified life. You must lead an enhanced style of life. It must be distributed to various amount of people. It must extend, expand and enhance the levels of people. So this is the purpose. So it has not been achieved at all and we are seeing adverse effects. That is the first failure of Western knowledge and practice. The second thing is, they want purpose, that is family relation and also good relation between the elders and the youngsters. That is, first I have told about the domestic relations of consorts. And second thing, it is between generations. Third thing, it is between the subjects and the ruler, the ruling system and the subjects. So all of these things formally, they deal with an integral system of well-developed and well-nourished facility by which a person can live a life of comfort. This is the purpose for which they don't have any tools. What is the greatness of us? We have five greatness, which is very salient, distinct, distinguished and distinguishable from the Western schools of the thought. Number one, it is the school of Ananta, infinity. We are connected always with infinity, so as we are having the perpetual source of inspiration and perennial bestowal of the charge. And we are connected with infinity, number one. And number two, we are based on scriptures and the religions are not based on scriptures. And even they call that as bibliographic sources of scriptures, but they don't have the qualities of apurusheyatva, that is originless, nitya nirdosha, eternally blemishless, svata pramanya, axiomatic, avichinna gurprampara prapta, that which has been procured by uninterrupted disciplinic succession and disciplinic succession. So this is the greatness, the pramana, or this spiritual wealth of a scriptural bounty is not there with them, number two. And number three, acharya sishya bhava. Acharya is different from a teacher, tutor or thinker or somebody else. We are having a lot of creative thinkers of the West, philosophers of the West, and we are having a lot of think tanks, intellectuals, intelligentsia, innumerable people are available also in the West. They are born out of their intellectual exercises. Nayamatma pravachanena labhya na medhayana bahunashrutena. They are having these three tools of pravachana, medha and bahushruti. So these things are about the eternal pursuit of knowledge and eternity made by the self-determined spirit of them by which they have undergone intellectual exercises, not with the lineage of their acharyas and with the shruti parampara, by which their knowledge is limited and the adverse effects are not prevented. They could not preclude the adverse effects of their knowledge and the knowledge is incomplete. So these type of think pads, these type of executors, they are very limited in their knowledge as well as in their execution. Because this is intellectual exercise. For us, we are having spiritual exercise. A teacher according to Acharya, what we call as Acharya. Now there are lot of English synonyms. If we can look for the synonyms, they are very proximate or they are very resemblant, but they are not resplendent as that of the glory of an Acharya. An Acharya is a person who knows what that is to be known, and also he knows what he knows, and he can make us also know what he knows. And he does what he knows. He also who can instill in that doing capacity what he does. This is the greatest of an Acharya. Such people are anguli maya, accountable within your fingers. We have produced Acharyas and they have produced thinkers, intellectuals, other people. They are entirely different. We cannot compare these two people with that for excellence. They are entirely different. So this Acharya Parampara is our greatness. And the fourth thing is Paramapurusha. We are having the ultimate reality of God and we see everything in divinity. Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma Tajjalam is the statement of Upanishad. Everything is coming from God, sustainable by the divinity, and everything is dissolved in the God. So everything is divine. That type of seeing oneness in everything, that type of seeing that the divinity and eternity in all ephemeral structures also, seeing the parasentience in each and every sentient and insentient members of the representative family of the cosmic kingdom, that is our greatness. And fifth thing is our achara, our austerity, penance, celibacy, and all of other practices that will burn all of our sins. And anudaya samshaya viparya vismriti vipulipsa. These are the barriers for getting real wisdom. Anudaya is nescience, viparya is misapprehension, vismriti is oblivion, samshaya is suspicion, vipulipsa is deception and deceiving others. All of these innate natures of deviated form of wisdom or diluted, dilapidated form of wisdom will not occur in a case where a person's jnana wisdom is made radiant, resplendent, brilliant and effulgent with spiritual exercise. These five greatness of us that distinguishes us from the Eastern school of thought and also the Western school of thought, wherein the intellectual exercises are predominant because of lack of two things. One is scriptural lineage, second is spiritual lineage. Any person without a scripture, he is said to be motherless, and any person without an Acharya, he is said to be fatherless. So those people, the Western think tanks, they are orphans being totally abdicated, abandoned by the schools of thought of scriptural and spiritual lineage. So whatever they want to get for four things, one is physical salubrity, second mental sharpness, third thing intellectual sturdity, fourth thing is spiritual valor, color and glamour. For getting all these benefits, they have to be dependent on some source. Just as if we are affected with something else, we go towards the West out of a mania, and that must be an oriental mania, which is nothing but a real way of understanding the oriental wisdom and greatness, the ideological wealth and treasure. They have to come back here to get these things. Number one, physical salubrity. Whatever the medicines that have been invented, they have not understood the two major functions of our human body. Number one, it is activated by functional forces like Pitta, Vata and Sleshma. If the functional forces are not understood and merely going to microbiology, parasitology, archaeology, fungology, immunology, virology and bacteriology, understanding of all of these microbes without understanding your functional forces and the determination, they cannot come to a real solution. It will result in nishpala, viparitapala or alpapala. And that is what we are getting in medicines. But that's why we used to say about doctors, a famous saying, namastubhyam, vaidyarale yamaraja sahodara, Yamastu harate pranan to pranan dharne vache. I worship you, my dear doctor, family doctor. You are the big brother of Yama. Yama just, he loots only our life, but you are taking our life along with our wealth. So, that is the greatness for our school of thought that includes the functional forces of Vada, Pitta and Sleshma. Once I attended a microbiology conference, wherein by an entomologist spoke that there are millions of things that are the microbes in the world, and they are detecting with various other subtlest microscopes and latest other inventions. I told that if you are starting with analyzing the things outside, that will be lakhs in number, millions in number, and you have to spend your life only in analysis, not in medication. But if you understand, instead of the things which are intruding you, if you understand the impact what it makes on your body, then you can come to a conclusion, because those things, microbes are millions in number. But the impacts made inside the body by those microbes, they are very limited to Vata, Pitta and Sleshma. They have to upgrade or degrade only any of these three things. So it is a limited origin, so we can easily read these things. Number two, the intrusion of study of mind and its role on medication. The role of mind and body is known as medication. The mind and spirit is known as things are the major principles of the contribution of mind. So they don't accept mind at all. Now they are starting psychology, psychiatry, neuropsychology, neuropsychiatry, psychometry, psychonomy, parapsychology, innumerable sciences they have started. started, even with technology of consciousness understanding, so they are gradually coming towards the Eastern thought or Oriental wisdom. So, physical. Second thing is this mental balance. There are three qualities of our practice in which it gives contentment, sacrifice and renunciation. Contentment means it is a status, it is also, all of these things appear to be synonymous. But they have different levels of gravity. Contentment lies in the family life, and sacrifice lies in the common life, and renunciation lies in the total abdication of worldliness for a spiritual bliss. These things are just having degree variations. This type of sturdity gives you to withstand any number of hurdles and to contribute something for the welfare of the society and nation at large. These three things are the think products as well as the brain products of our Eastern school of wisdom. Third thing is intellectual purpose. The purpose of intellectual wisdom or the intellectual training is not creating anything as per the gymnastics. As per the requirement we have to create, not per the capability. For example, you can cut anybody's hand and you can annex a tadpole's hand. Now they are doing research about including the cells of pigs and rabbits for human development and tissue culture and their adaptability they are researching. You cannot just keep on doing things on the basis of your capability, on the basis of the real long-term solubility as well as the necessity you have to go through. So whatever their intellect is there, as it is misguided, as it is vidhava, as it is having no proper concept to manage it, that is becoming streamlined in a pathway of destruction, self-destruction, and also universal annihilation of all of the dependents and believers. So that is the greatness. And the spiritual thing is quite unknown to other people. So what it is India century? Number one, in physical salubrity, you are getting into problem, and India can teach you yoga, naturopathy, and Ayurveda to the world. Mental sturdity by means of tapa, dhyana, and various other sabhacharanas. That is the sublimits of that type, pranayama, pratyahara. You can qualify your mind and control that. Scientists invent everything through their brain. They don't know about the brain at all. They survive by their soul, but they don't know about the soul at all. They think by their mind and execute, but they don't know about the mind at all. Everything is being done by the fundamental force of the universe, the Paramatma, and they don't know about the availability and arrival of such a person at all. So, not available on the basis of the fundamentals, the rudimentary primordial factors of their survival, which necessitates and urges them into action and activation, they are incomplete and they are deserted, they are abandoned, and it is the duty of us, not in the way of a destroyer and a receiver, not in the way of a king and a subject, as East is always the big brother of the West. It is our compassion, it is our fraternity, it is our maternal care that we have to give hands to the West. And we have to enroll them into our honest, noble and transcendental embrace in which their physique, mind, intellect and spirit is made comfortable. It is given solace, eternal solace, inexhaustible prosperity and real peace. That will be contribution of the big brother. Now with a brotherly bhava, brethren, we have to unite with the West. The West will realize and come soon. And you know that all greater journeys, they just begin with a small step, and today is a small step. And considering it as a small step, the available crowd, it appears to be colossal to me. It is more than a small step, and I believe that it will be fructified by the choices of blessings, the shower of the benedictions of the eternal reality who is instigating each and every person to unite. Already I told in the morning that it is a pre-sanctioned, pre-endorsed project of God, because it is a divine work. We are not taking our work. Even our work is done with the sanction of God, and if it is the work of divinity, certainly it is double sanctioned, and God has given us a blank check. Let us proceed and succeed. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.
I thank all the management and staff members of Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, Indian Heritage Academy, and Sri Ramananda Mission Trust, and all the other officers for their kind presence on this occasion. We owe special gratitude to the officials of the audiovisual staff, Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan staff, volunteers, and officials who have worked hard to ensure that this occasion becomes a memorable.
In a prayerful mood, invoking the Almighty Lord, known by various names, that this mission which you are starting today may take off, crawl, creep, walk, run, at whatever speed we discern. After all, there's a karma. Everything depends upon how much we discern. Adhikaratva, eligibility, qualification, effort, competence, character.
Karunya bhavena
raksha raksha
raksha raksha
maheshwara
maheshwara.
Our civilization has gone up because of